If you have a Bible, turn with me really quickly to Matthew chapter 5. Quickly, look at the person next to you, though, and say, I prayed all year that I would sit next to you right now. We got to turn up the keyboard. We got to get, yeah. Everything sounds more spiritual. And then quickly, look at the other person, choice number two today, for whatever reason. Look at them and say, God has big plans for your life. Matthew chapter 5. How you guys doing down here in the spitting zone? All right. Amazing. How you guys doing way up top in the spiritual seats? You good? Yep. If Jesus comes back this afternoon, you go first. Save us room. We love you. Matthew chapter 5. I'll give you a second to get there. Huge shout out to everybody who lifted up your light last night, admitting that you're still on a journey trying to figure all this out. We are so glad to have people here that realize you don't have to believe what we believe to belong in a place like Passion. We are just glad you're here. So for those of you that are searching, you're in the right place. We love you. Matthew 5, it says this, and I'm not going to preach long, just about 2.5 hours, but I want to get this out. And I realize there's different backgrounds, different styles of preaching and listening, and you can sit, you can take notes. I'm from Virginia, so yes, yes, I'm going to preach right here the whole time. And, you know, some people listen to, some people listen to messages silently, that's fine. And I'm from Virginia, though, where people will shout you down as you're preaching, and there's no shame in that. Our culture is run from anything that's remotely emotional, and I don't think that's the answer either. So if you want to say amen, you can. If you want to say preach it, you can. I actually have preached in churches where the people are so incredible, their feedback is better than my messages. So one time I said, God is good. Some lady stood up, and she was like, he is good. He was good yesterday. He's good now. He's going to be good tomorrow. I said, okay, that's fine. Matthew chapter 5. Jesus said this. He said, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and they give light to everybody in the house. In that same way, let your light shine before men, that they might see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. I love that scripture. Look at somebody and say, shine. Oh, that was professional. Look at somebody and say, shine, like you mean it. Off the back of what Pastor John just preached, I love it to be able to sit in here and realize that Jesus has done the work, saved our lives, and we have a pretty clear call, which is to shine. I've called this message this afternoon, Occupy All Streets. Just in case you're taking notes, you don't have to take notes, but realize all preachers judge you inside if you don't take notes. I love Jesus, saved my life, and I read the gospel over and over, and I'm just in love with the fact that Jesus ministered to everybody. There were no streets that Jesus Christ did not impact. If you were poor, Jesus was coming for you. If you were rich, Jesus was not afraid of you. If you were a leper, Jesus was laying down with you until you got well. If you were an outcast, Jesus spent his whole life reminding people that I came for you. I believe in that same way, what is represented in this room is the ability for us to occupy all streets with the light of the gospel. There should be no campus, there should be no prison, there should be no back alley, there should be no ghetto, there should be no village that has not heard the goodness of our God. If we can shine this light, as John said, the glory of our God is so unbelievable, we can see God do something in our lifetimes that we have yet to even imagine. Occupy all streets. I do know this. I don't want to be in a position where I have been doing a lot of things, but I've missed the whole point. I feel like that's the danger sometimes in our culture. That's why I love Matthew 5:13, because it's basically Jesus making sure that people don't miss the point. All this stuff is great, but don't forget to shine. All the knowledge is great, but don't forget to shine. Don't forget to reach somebody. I don't want to miss the point. Have you ever known somebody that's missed the point? Like somebody apologizes to you and they're like, I'm sorry, you deserved it, but I'm sorry. Or somebody forgets your birthday and they give you a present after the fact. They're like, sorry, I forgot your birthday. Here's your present 3 days later. And you're like, kind of missed the point. There is a danger in Christendom that we can go to the conferences, know the Bible, sing the songs, get all the knowledge, do all the Christian kumbaya stuff, but we actually miss the point, which is to shine the light of our God everywhere we go. I don't want to miss the point. You know, my daughter, Charlie, she's up there, and not too long ago, the water's good in Atlanta, by the way. We wanted to take her to see her great-grandma in Scotland before she went into eternity. And me and Laura had spent weeks getting her ready for this trip. We had done all the trappings. We had, you know, prepared her. We had packed her bags. We had, you know, mentally got her excited to see her lineage and to go to a different country. And we finally got to the airport. This is horrible, but I'm just going to share my pain with you. Finally got to the airport, and she's got her bag. She's ready to roll. And I gave the lady at the ticket counter my ticket and my passport and everything and Laura's. And then I gave her Charlie's. And the lady looks at me. And she looks up at me and gives me that death stare. And she's like, sir, her passport is expired. And I immediately looked at my wife, like all good husbands do. And I'm like, this is your fault. Like, are you serious? We have everything. Like, you didn't check, like, the one thing, which is the expiration date. My wife did what all good wives do. Smiled. It's your fault. And we were having one of those silent fights, and I'm asking the lady, I'm like, can we just get through? Can you just kind of overlook it? Like, you can overlook, like, a passport validity issue, which they can't. And she's like, sir, you're just going to have to tell her. And I, you know, basically took the horrible role. I said, Laura, I'll tell Charlie. And I remember sitting Charlie down, and I said, I know you're excited about this trip, and I know we have, it looks like we're almost there, but Daddy made a mistake, and your passport is expired, and we can't go on this trip. All this stuff has been for nothing. And she looks at me. Big alligator tears. She's like, Dad, it's okay. I still love you. And I said, give me a second. I'm going to go outside, and I'm going to light myself on fire, and then I'm going to come back in here. Worst moment ever, where we had almost made it but missed the essence of what this whole thing is about. Sometimes I talk to Christians and I see churches and I just wonder, do we know the essence of this gospel is to give it to the broken and give it to the hurting and give it to the needy? It's not about getting stuff. We've got the stuff. It is Jesus. It's not about taking new ground. He's taken all the ground. It's about Jesus. And I pray with all the messages and all that God is doing in this conference, if I can do one thing today, it would be to remind some of you to occupy your street with the love of the gospel like you never have before. Because people outside these four walls are dying. We have the answer. Can you write this down? I've called this the Occupy Revelation. If you're not familiar with church terms, I believe a revelation is something that God speaks to you. It's that moment where you're reading the Bible and it's like, wow, somebody didn't preach that to me. I got it. I believe today some of you need to get a revelation. And here it is. This is the Occupy Revelation. Who you are is not defined by what you do, but it is defined according to who Jesus is to you. Let me say it again. Who you are is not defined by what you do, not defined by an earthly label, not defined by what somebody else called you, but who you are is defined by who Jesus is to you. So if what I'm saying is true right now, there should be some excitement welling up in you because you might not have the right label just yet. You might not have all your ducks in the row just yet. But if Jesus is your Lord and Jesus is your Savior and Jesus is your Creator, that means you don't need somebody else to give you external validation to be effective. You have internal confirmation that God has called me. He has commissioned me. I got every right to start activating my gifting right now. I'm going to read you one of my favorite stories in the Bible. Is it okay if we read the Bible twice? And this is in Luke Go there with me real quick. How many people are actually actively in college right now? How many people have graduated? All right. How many married couples do we have at Passion? All right, married people are always like, how many single people do we have here today? Okay. All right, you keep your eyes on Jesus. You just focus. And this is Luke chapter 19, story of Jesus and Zacchaeus. And I love it because Jesus breaks so many paradigm boxes. He does so many things. You could preach for years out of Zacchaeus, which I'm sure Pastor John has. How profound is John Piper? He says more profound things by accident than I do on purpose my whole life. Here's the story. It says, Jesus entered Jericho, and there was a man that was passing through. He was passing through. A man by the name of Zacchaeus was there, and he was the chief tax collector, and he was wealthy. Little Bible context. He wasn't just like a wealthy dude. He was absolutely hated by all. He was hated by all segments of society because he was wealthy, and the way he got his wealth was even worse. Long story, but just know this guy was hated. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and he climbed a sycamore fig tree to see Jesus coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. Here we have the first biblical example of somebody inviting themselves over for dinner. Incredible. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. Can I just tell you this, y'all? I pray you're living the kind of life where somebody is muttering and grumbling and blogging and tweeting and misunderstanding you, because when you're pleasing God, often you're going to displease some people, but then you got to ask yourself who you're working for. But Zacchaeus stood up and he said, Lord, look, here and now I give half my possessions to the poor, and if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. And Jesus said, today salvation has come to this home because this man is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Come on, somebody. That deserves a Pentecostal shout down something. Here. Some of you haven't moved. You know why I love this? Because Jesus had nothing but his identity, strolls up, has no degree, has no spiritual weight, but he just shows up and turns a dinner meeting into a revival moment where it leads to somebody else's salvation. I believe till the end of time, what Jesus was teaching us is not about what the label the world wants you to have. It's about the label that God has given you. Jesus just showed up, reaches somebody in a tree, and the next thing you know, somebody's eternity is completely different. I love this. It encourages me, and it wants me to, you know, lead me to remind a couple of you, I don't care what somebody else has called you. I don't care what you walked in here thinking you do or don't have. If you have the anointing of our God, you have the right to be able to walk through wherever you're walking, look up into some trees where nobody else is looking, and realize God can use me here. Does that encourage anybody else? Every time I read this story, it blows me away. When you get this, you're no longer just to anything. You are a walking revival. You know why I say this? There are a lot of people in your age bracket who are thinking, well, right now I'm just a college student, but there's going to be a moment. Right now I'm just a, no way. When you get the Occupy All Streets revelation, you're no longer just an anything. You are an agent of change called by God to impact people wherever you go. Jesus was just walking around. He only had one title his whole life. Carpenter, but he was always the Messiah. So some of you need to realize, just because your label on this earth doesn't mean much, it does not mean you don't have the right to shine the light of the gospel. You're not just a coffee worker. You are a bean revivalist. Wait, I pray somebody comes into this Starbucks today, because I'm gonna make a difference. You are not just a college student. You are a walking revival everywhere you go. You're not waiting for that moment till you get your ducks in the row. They don't have to be in a row. Jesus died and rose again, so you never have to wait another day in your life to be effective. God's called you now. I'm trying to stay sophisticated. When you get this, everything changes. I remember hearing a story of a police officer who wrote me an email. And he said, you know, I used to think that my ministry was going to be after I was done being a police officer. Because our world, keep in mind, we have put some callings with the VIP label and others with not so VIP. Isn't that funny? Like how somehow this stage is more important than those seats. Even though Jesus stood to disrupt every sort of paradigm like that. The story of the gospel is not famous superstars. It is faithful servants doing what God's called them to do day in and day out. But this guy said, I thought someday I was going to be a pastor. And I was going to start my ministry. And then I started hearing messages and reading the Bible and realizing I don't know what I'm waiting for. I don't have to have someone call me an evangelist or call me a pastor to actually start reaching some people. He said, so what I started doing as a police officer, I would always arrest people, put them in the back of the car, and take them to the station. And he said, that wasn't good enough anymore. I said, I'm going to occupy my street a little differently, and I'm going to be prepared in case God needs me. So what I do now is I will arrest somebody, I'll throw them in the back of my car, and on the way to the police station, I'll just hold up a video link of one of y'all's sermons, and I'll just play them the word of God, because where are they going to go? And he said, by the time we got to the station, some people would be weeping, not because they were about to go to jail, but because of what they heard. Some people would have questions. Sometimes dudes would get out of jail, come track me down and say, can you tell me a little bit more about what you were playing in that car? Because something gripped my heart. What if I told you that God has a story and a plan for you, and it includes you leaving this conference, not forgetting your responsibility to shine the light of the gospel? How come four people were with me on that point? Because that should be you. There's a woman in my church who's a hero. She's a four-time cancer survivor. Double mastectomy. She's Puerto Rican. She is fierce. Any Puerto Ricans in the place? Hey. Seven. Awesome. All you need is two. Place gets live. And she said to me, after her fourth bout, with cancer. And I said, how you doing, Arlene? You okay? Your spirits high? She said, of course, I'm good. She said, I believe God's my healer, even though I haven't seen my healer. I believe that God's my source. I'm gonna be all right. She said, matter of fact, I've just prayed for my healing, but now I'm focused on reaching my chemotherapy people in the room with me. She said, last week I brought eight of them to church. You know, they got saved. And this week, you know, I walk in there and I keep reminding the devil, you should have killed me when you had a chance, because I don't want to be in this chemo room, but if I'm going to be in this chemo room, I'm going to actually look for somebody to reach. She said, now that's my mission field. So as long as I got cancer, I'm going to make the devil pay for putting me in that hospital. As long as I don't have my hair and I love my hair, I'm going to make the devil pay for giving me this disease. I'm going to fight for people. What are we doing? As Christians that know the gospel, know the beauty of our God, but yet we are hesitant to give the greatest news of all. I pray you leave passion, not going, oh, it was a good moment. Oh, I loved that thing, an album that I bought, or the message. I pray you leave here going, I'm going to occupy my street. I don't care if people don't think I'm qualified. God qualified me. I don't care how bad my past is. I know that Jesus said, old things are gone, the new things are here. I am going to reach somebody. It's not about what we're saying. It's about what Jesus has already done. And if we will open up our lives, we can see things like this matter. Can I give you two ways quickly to occupy your street? Just two suggestions? No? And then we're going to get David Crowder and their amazing team back up here. We're going to worship God some more. I wish I would have known I would have been teaming up with them. I would have shaved this abominable beard. Some of the best beards I've ever seen on that stage. Two ways to occupy your street better. And I'm not a conference speaker, I'm a pastor. Day in and day out in New York City, we're just dealing with people who are trying to do what they can do to shine the light of the gospel. And I got two ideas for you. I've actually got 22. Should we get all 22 in? No? Number one, I propose that you occupy wide awake. There's probably more joy in this journey than you have seen in your life just yet. Occupy wide awake. What I love about Jesus walking in through this town, keep in mind, he had somewhere else to go, and I'm sure you're busy, but I don't think you were as busy as Jesus would have been. Jesus is walking through on the way to somewhere else, and he is so wide awake that he passes a tree and sees somebody in there and turns it into a revival moment. been sitting over there watching people worship and trying to hear the voice of God. And I feel prompted to plead with somebody in here that God's word for you right now would be to wake up, because he's doing more than you know. He's working in ways that you cannot see. And I believe it's human nature to want to close our eyes to the beauty of our God every day and just get caught in the monotonous flow of life. Just another day, another struggle. Gym flow, work flow, school flow, quiet time flow, hashtag. Another day, another struggle. We just go, and we just go, and slowly but surely, we close our eyes to the supernatural, because it doesn't look spectacular, forgetting that God loves to intervene in the supernormal and use nobodies like us to tell anybodies like the people outside about the somebody who can change their life. But we've got people that are walking around like they're asleep. I don't want to get caught as a Christian living rushed because I wasn't ready. You can write that down. You can tweet it. Send it to somebody. I don't want to live rushed because I wasn't ready. You know what I mean by that? Have you ever like overslept an alarm? Worst thing ever, right? The rest of your day you're rushed and you're running all around. You got the wrong shoes on. You're fighting with people you don't want to fight with. You just feel totally rushed because you weren't ready, because you overslept. I think some Christians are in that position where they're never actually present in the now, because they weren't ready. They weren't awake to what God is doing. As a parent, I've got three children, two of which are definitely saved. They're here. My son, he's making his decision. He's five. But as a parent, you got to make sure that you're present, that you don't just start going through the motions. And I'll give you a little warning. Someday, your kids are going to have stuff like school recitals, okay? A couple things you need to know. I just went to one, Charlie's. It was at 8 a.m. on a Friday morning. Further proof the public school system cares about nobody but themselves. And I remember Laura saying, we got to go to this recital. It's at 8 a.m. And keep in mind, y'all, you're going to go to your kid's recital. It's not really your kid's recital. They're going to be doing something for 2 minutes, and you are bound by law to sit there in these recitals and watch kids you don't care about do stuff you don't want to see, and you cannot leave. They will tase you if you try to go. They will steal 2 hours of your life. And Laura's like, we have to go. And I'm like, I don't want to go. I want to sleep. And I'm like, you wake me up at 7:59. That's my job as a day. You wake me up and we're going to go. And all I remember that morning, I don't remember much. I don't remember where I was going. I don't remember what we were doing. But I remember me and Laura just strolled in. There's all these other, you know, awesome parents, like perfectly dressed, like taking pictures of little Johnny. And me and my wife kind of stroll in like, we're the pastors around here. Matter of fact, I have photographic evidence of how not awake I was. Can y'all look at this? Am I eating my breakfast? Absolutely. Don't judge me at all. I don't remember the photo. I don't remember my wife judging me. But I remember leaving and going back to bed, and about 1 o'clock, I remember going, Laura, did we do something this morning? She's like, yeah, we did. We went to your daughter's recital. I remember thinking, did you get any pictures of it? Like, did we record it? Like, I was there, but I wasn't really there. I think there's a lot of people who are going to look back on their college years and go, what did I do? I mean, are you kidding me? Was I actually on a college campus where every single day I had the right to reach somebody? What did I do with that moment in time? Was I actually awake to what God was doing? What if I told you way up there in the back that God is doing more than you're seeing? What if I told you last year that God was blessing you in areas you didn't recognize, that he was working in ways you did not see? Our job is to keep our eyes wide open to the goodness of our God. Somebody in here, you need to wake up, because God wants to use you to shine the light of the gospel on the street that you are occupying right now. Is this helping anybody in here? Are you hearing my heart? Maybe this will help. In our church, we do these things called For Monday, meaning we don't want people to shout us down on Sunday and do nothing on Monday. If we're having good church meetings on the weekend, but nobody's changing lives on the weekdays, we are failing miserably. If nothing changes on your campus this Monday, what we've done this week doesn't really matter all that much. Our prayer is that this will not be a moment, it would be a movement. Having said that, I call this For Monday, something you can put into practice in a couple days from now. For Monday, wake up and ask yourself this question: who can I serve? Is that profound enough, theologically sound for everybody? Who can I serve? Think about Jesus. What if he would have walked around like some of us do? It's not my moment. It's not my week to serve. I'm so glad that Jesus didn't walk by Zacchaeus like, not now, buddy. I'm a Scorpio. It's not my time right now. It's not what I do. I'm having an introspective season. What if you woke up, started saying, who can I serve? Who can I love? What can I do? God, how can you use me? I promise you, you will see fruit on your street. I promise you, you will start to see God move in ways you did not expect. But here's the hitch. Don't get discouraged when it doesn't happen instantly, because God is working constantly. We are the Instagram generation, y'all. People just want to watch SportsCenter highlights. They don't want to see the game. People want to see the photograph, like the final picture. No one wants to know the story. But anytime you see men and women of God that have done great things, please understand there was a great price of monotony they paid to wake up every day and go, who am I going to serve? I don't care about the return. Obedience is my job. Outcome is God's job. I'm going to wake up every day and I'm going to be kind. I'm going to help somebody. I'm not just going to go to school to take classes. I'm going to go to have God use me. Where we are right now is a little bit, obviously, it's what God's doing. But Louie and Shelly have been faithful in the shadows for years. Who can we serve? How can we help? So what you see here is great. But let me take you back down memory lane real quick. Do you know this, Louie and Shelly? Put the first photo up, guys. Just a quick photo of the hottest couple. I don't know if they saw this then, but their eyes spiritually were open. 1999, how about this photo? Louie, I don't know if y'all remember this. Thousands of people, incredible meeting. I don't know if it was this arena packed, but I do know they woke up. Who can we serve? What can we do? We're not looking at the big picture. That's God's job. We're looking at the everyday, carrying the cross, helping people. Now, fast forward to last night, you see photos like this, and that's what people talk about. But that's the end of the line. That's a picture of what it looks like when Christians wake up and say, God, I am wide awake. You want me to show up to school today with a happy spirit? So be it. You want me to go to church and hold a door? So be it. You want me to turn the other cheek when somebody's being bad to me? So be it. My job on this planet is to live an open life, to be generous with people so they can see the beauty of my God through my broken life. Wake up! I want to encourage some of you in here that have been trying to minister to people and you haven't seen much fruit. Nobody Instagrams the bad days in church. Nobody talks about the Bible studies on the campuses that you're trying to start and it's not going well. Can I, number one, tell you that you're a hero and that God's doing things that you cannot see? Remain wide awake. Do not quit. Do not stop. You keep loving people and God will use your life. Can somebody say amen? They agree with me on this. Don't leave. Don't leave the room because it's not working. Have y'all ever sat through one of those old, bad, like scary movie flicks where you have like the totally predictable plot line where the guy's out there doing bad things and there's always that party scene? Typically it's at a college and people are dancing and there's always that one random girl, typically a white girl, and she's like, I'm gonna go outside for no apparent reason, even though people have been murdered out there for weeks. I'm just gonna go take a walk outside. And she goes outside, and people are in the theater yelling at the screen as if you can change the narrative of a screenplay that's been written. Don't go out there, girl! Don't go out there! There's a killer out there. Why would you leave? Stay in there. And then you watch as she floats on into the forest, and she never comes back. You're like, ah! I wonder sometimes if heaven heaves with the same kind of passion telling people like you and I when we're tempted to get out because we don't see it working. I wonder if we would just stay in a little bit longer, if we would keep praying a little bit longer, if we would keep pressing into God just a little bit longer, people we're believing for, they will find God. People that we want to see help, they will get help. But some of you, I pray today that you remain wide awake to the goodness of our God. And number two, as we close, and David and your band, y'all can get up here, we're gonna worship or whoever, just a moment, that's my first close. I've got seven, so don't get excited. I preach in New York City, a lot of ADD people, so we have all kinds of stuff we do. Any New Yorkers in here? All right. Occupy, wide awake, and number two as we close, I want you to occupy with urgency. The clock is ticking, Passion Conference, and we need to get moving. I pray there's some urgency rising up in you even as we're preaching right now. Because the clock is ticking, and we gotta get moving. Love this moment with Jesus because he could have put it off, could have done something else, but he looked at this guy who was not on his plan for the day, was not part of his calendar meetings, and he looked at Zacchaeus and he said, I'm coming to your house. We're having dinner right now. Love that. Wonder if there are times where we don't realize the urgency of the situation. I pray that in this room right now you would realize this big differential moment here. Urgency doesn't make you weird. It just makes you effective. Because sometimes when we think of urgency, we think of the weird Christians who do weird things and they're pressing people. I don't believe true God-given urgency makes you weird. I believe it makes you effective because you wake up every day going, this could be the day. I pray that your future is bright. And I pray that you have a long life ahead of you. But the essence of the gospel was originally preached to people that were probably going to die with a very short lifespan. So everything you see in the New Testament, sometimes you feel the urgency. We have missed this. In our culture, we have limited time to occupy these streets. And I pray somebody in here, you're already feeling, oh my gosh, Lord, there's things I have to do and there's people I have to reach. And here's the best news ever. Even if you're not from, I guess there's people from all over the world in here, but in New York City, there is such a void of kindness and generosity that if you are urgent with your kindness, and you are urgent with your gentle spirit and the hope that is Jesus Christ moving through your life, you will stand out like a sore thumb. You don't need a mixtape. You don't need to have a lot of followers on Twitter. You just have to show up on the job every day as a New Yorker and just be a little bit kind, and people will be blown away. You can open the door for somebody and people will be like, oh my gosh. Do you know that our world is so broken and so sick that if you would stop looking at you and start looking at Jesus, not what you lack, but what he has put in you, you would actually urgently step out more than you do, because this gospel is really about the hand-to-hand combat, person-to-person, woman-to-woman, reaching people every day. That's what the gospel is to me. I remember walking in New York and people have said to me, oh, Carl, you're an evangelist. And I'll say, I don't agree with you at all. I think I'm just urgent. And I'm sick of watching people die, and I'm sick of going to funerals, and I'm sick of watching the devil rob people with this lie that is sin. So when God opens up a door, I'm gonna step in there. I don't care if I look like an idiot. I don't care if I say the wrong thing, which is typically 99% of the time what we do. I'll just take a moment. One of the biggest evangelistic weapons I have in my life is my love of shoes. I found myself on the subway one day, and I was just next to a guy, and I was like, hey man, because in New York City, you can be this close to people, and they try to act like you're not existing. Say, hey man, cool shoes. He's like, thanks. Yours are cool too. I'm like, you want to come to church? I got a good church down the road. God's changed my life. He's like, yeah, I've been thinking about that. My heart's hurt. You know, I got some broken areas. That'd be pretty cool. Where is it? There was no cloud. There was no David Crowder. There was no Louis talking about space and God and awesomeness. There was just a subway and a window and a fallible broken vessel that has at least learned one thing. God can use broken vessels like me to somehow shine the light on the perfect Savior that he is. What if you woke up on Monday with an urgent expectation that today is the day? I'm gonna walk by some trees that other people have overlooked, and God is gonna use my life. We're gonna close, but I pray that you are willing to do whatever it takes. And I know this is practical, y'all. It's all I got. I know this is something you have to actually outwork in your life, but our church is filled with people that are willing to do whatever it takes. They're not impressed with the platform. They have not bought the lie that Christendom sometimes propagates, which is, you know, the fancier you are and the more titles you have and the more people give you praise, somehow the holier you are. I'm grateful that I'm a part of a local community of believers that realize we don't need a label. There is no red VIP tape. If you are in this game, meaning you have committed your life to Jesus, you are just as effective as anybody else. God can use your life. Your call is holy. I love that. But the very first person that got saved at Hillsong New York City, it was also the very first person that we did a funeral for. And his story is unbelievable because he was a product of New York City through and through. Arrested over 20 times, worked in nightclubs, he was a model, he was a bartender, he had struggled with years and years of abuse. And I used to invite him to church because he used to say, I don't want you to talk to me about Jesus. Now, I believe in God, but I don't believe in Jesus. And I'd say, well, Jesus is God, so just be quiet, just keep on coming. And he would start coming to church, and he would always let me know. He's like, I'm not coming to church for any other reason than there's girls in there. And I'm like, that's fine. You know, just keep on coming, whatever it takes. I mean, people can handle it. Keep on coming. And week after week, he would sit there, and I would watch his face change, just being around the glory of God, watching God do what he can do through broken people like our church is filled with. And I remember the day that he came running down the stairs to tell me, he said, Carl, yeah, I got saved in my quiet time today. I did something that you guys always say to do. I read my Bible and I was just praying, and somehow I understand this and I'm a Christian today and it's awesome. And I remember thinking, that's the craziest story ever, because I thought it was going to happen a different way, but it happened like that. And he told me something before he passed away. He said, Carl, you know what did it for me? He said, you know how you always get people to turn to each other and how it's all awkward? Well, I secretly used to say it was awkward, but I used to like it. Because I don't talk to anybody all week. I refuse to get emotional. I'm trying to think of cats or something horrible. Bring it back. He said, I didn't talk to anybody all week. And he said, sometimes people would hug me, and I used to hate it. I used to hate it. And I used to say, no, I'm not coming to church today. No one's going to hug me. But secretly, I would come to church. I mean, music is all right, and you're preaching what it is. But I used to come waiting for those hugs, because no one's hugged me for years. And I would act like I didn't like it. But he said, week after week, people kept hugging me. And I would try to act like I didn't want it. But I would just kind of look around for hugs. Because we take a moment in church, and we just say, hey, give somebody a hug. And he used to say, week after week, I felt like it was God chipping away at this icy cold heart. And there came a day where there was nothing left, and I saw Jesus for who he was. It was not our music, which is overrated. It was not the preaching of churches that gets the credit. It was not that. It was the hugs of everyday, ordinary people that came into church going, I can't sing today. I'm not preaching today. I don't have a label today. But what is God going to call me to do? I guarantee you, there was nobody in our church that thought God's going to use me to be the hug that breaks the camel's back in that regard. No, people just saying, what's it going to be today, Lord? Can I plead with you? Maybe take my word for it that our world is so broken. And there are people that are so desperate that if we can go back to Matthew 5:13 and just say, God, help me to shine. We're going to be in moments like this, but there are going to be more people. Different nationalities, different races. We can be a part of something in our lifetime where we look back and say, wow, look at what God did with a bunch of broken people like us. As we close, the last four Monday, write this down. Can you remove someday and almost from your vocabulary? Be my last plea at Passion this year. Can you remove someday and almost from your vocabulary? Those are two curse words I want nothing to do with. You know how many Christians suffer from the someday, almost disease? Someday, I'm gonna do something awesome. Right now, I'm busy. Someday, I'm gonna write that song, but I gotta make sure I have the right theology. I gotta make sure I'm a professional musician. Someday, I'm gonna bring a friend to Passion. Someday, I'm gonna serve. Or the almost people. I almost prayed for you. Thanks. Hey, Louie, heard Passion was great. I almost came. Almost someday, almost someday. All I know as a preacher on this stage right now is that Jesus Christ did not almost go all the way to the grave and back for us. He didn't almost die. He didn't almost sacrifice everything. He didn't almost lay his life down so broken people like us could find hope in him. He went all the way. And our only reasonable response in here is to say, Lord, I'm not going to almost give you all of me. I'm going to give you everything. I'm not going to almost get rid of my excuses. I'm going to get rid of them. I want you to use me. My prayer for you tonight, this afternoon, I don't even know what time it is. Can you stand to your feet so I can pray for you? I want you to take a moment as you stand. Stay with me here. Because there have been some moments in my life that have shaped me and wrecked me forever. And one of them was being in a meeting like this in Sydney, Australia. Almost the same amount of people. And I was standing next to a guy who had just graduated from Teen Challenge, which is a phenomenal rehab place for young men and women to go through. And there were people jumping up and down and worshiping. And he was sitting down and he was weeping. And his story is it's hard to hear. Sexually abused at a young age, spun him out in every various way you can imagine. Addicted to heroin, almost died. Somehow, by the grace of God, he was still going. Got saved, and he sat there, he was weeping. And I looked at him, I sat down, I said, why are you crying? And he looked at me, and I will never forget his words, because every time I come into a conference, I feel like it's what the Holy Spirit reminds me with. He looked at me, and he said, I wish somebody would have told me sooner. He said, all these people worshiping, known about this God. He said, I wish somebody would have told me sooner. I've been lonely. I've been alone. If somebody would have invited me, I would have came. If somebody would have told me, I would have listened. I just wish somebody would have told me sooner. And I remember sitting there in that meeting going, God, I can't do anything about what he's going through. But I want to be that somebody that gets a hold of somebody else before this world has a chance to rob what God wants to do in their life. My prayer for you in this room is that you would not wait another day to allow God to use you to occupy your street. If you're on a college campus, you are the revival. If you work at a gas station, you are the revival. If you're waiting for a breakthrough, stop. We already had a breakthrough. It happened on that cross and on that Calvary Hill where Jesus broke through the grave so Christians would never have to wait another day. I'm going to pray for you, then we're going to just take a moment and just breathe. Father, I ask you, Lord, that you would stir our hearts for lost people. Lord, that we would not get so caught up in the trappings of Christian life that we would forget that this gospel was meant to be given. Lord, I pray now that you would help people to lift their eyes above the storm and fix them on you, Jesus. For people who have felt like they've been on the outside looking in, remind people that you came for outcasts like us to give us access to your supernatural grace. Lord, we cry out for our college campuses, Lord. We refuse to stand idly by while people are hurt, lost, and dying. Lord, we pray for revival on campuses, Lord. We pray for the high schools. We pray for the streets that have been left for dead by Christianity for a long time, for Hollywood, for the music industry, for the sports world, for the entrepreneurs. God, I pray, raise us up to see your glory in these areas, and we give you praise ahead of time for all you're going to do in Jesus' name. If you believe it, can somebody shout amen with me? Can you give God a shout of praise?